This is Karen.
And this is our show.
What if it really works?
A practical guide to spirituality. And Karen, we're up here in the woods of California outside of Santa Cruz, sitting beside this incredible lake with lotus blossoms on it. And who is this guy?
We are really blessed today to be able to talk with Howard Martin. And Howard is the Executive Vice President of the Institute of HeartMath. And he handles the strategic development and has been working with the founder of this organization, Doc Childrey, since 1991. And Howard's book is, he co-authored with Doc Childrey, The HeartMath Solution. And we know that you have done incredible work because we followed this work for a number of years, but we welcome you to our viewers today, and we're so happy that you had the time that you could give us.
Thanks for having me. You guys are fun. This is going to be a great interview. I'm going to tell. I'm going to like this one. So good. Glad to have you. Glad you're here. And it is a beautiful day here in Northern California for us to sit outside and talk about some things we think count.
Yeah. And we need to clear up before we go any further that that is a Virginia, North Carolina accent you're struggling with.
It's actually Brooklyn. I've lived here now for 22 years, but the accent has remained. I actually keep it on purpose. It comes in handy.
Yeah, it does come in handy. Yeah. Especially when you live in New York.
That's right.
I know the drill. So you've been here for 22 years. Obviously, you were attracted because of the work, and then you started contributing to the work. How do you define what's going on here?
Well, you know, we've developed a system, you know, of tools, methods, and technology, all underpinned with scientific research to give it validity and credibility. And it was created a long time ago as we began the progression of where we are to where we are today to help empower people, you know, through these changing times. You know, Doc Childrey, our founder, a long time ago, long before we ever had a HeartMath, I've known Doc for a long time now, 40 years, we talk about times that were coming around, you know, the turn of the century when we were going to be in an era of unprecedented change, and that the challenges were going to be huge for society as well as the opportunities, but that people were going to need something. They were going to need a simple way that they could begin to deal with this, to develop the new intelligence capacity they needed to ride these waves of change with more poise and more grace. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, our early work on ourselves ended up being a discovery through the heart. We'd read about heart, and every spiritual book we read, every religion, every, you know, teaching that we'd run into, it all had references to heart. And we weren't touchy-feely guys by any means, but we figured we better take a look at it because everybody else was talking about it. Mm-hmm. And as we did, we found out, and especially Doc, who's, you know, been my mentor all this time with understanding heart and myself, we found that it was not just the same sort of philosophical or sentimental or emotional associations to heart. What it was a magnificent intelligence that we all possessed, that existed within everybody, that gets drowned out by the roar of ambition and survival, that needed a little dusting off and brought to the forefront of things, and then it could be applied and would be applicable to dealing with the changing times.
And you guessed right on that one for certain. But in the process of discovering the heart outside of the woo-woo, touchy-feely world of things, what's the key scientific thing you've discovered about the heart?
That the heart is not just a cardiovascular organ, that it sends information and commands to the brain and to the rest of the body, and it does it in four defined ways that are well known scientifically now. Neurologically, through a nervous system existing in the heart that communicates with the brain and the head through a nerve pathway starting out here and then going north. Through the blood pressure wave, which travels through the entire body, and electrical activity in our brain, for example, synchronizes to the changes in the blood pressure wave. The heart produces hormones. Who knew that? So it's part of our hormonal system now. It was actually reclassified as part of our hormonal system in 1983. And lastly, the electrical or energetic heart, which is the most fun part for me. Our heart's an electrical organ. When we go to a doctor, doctor's taking our EKG or ECG, what are they measuring? It's an electrical signal, and they see the signal, and they make some determination about the health of our heart. That signal is strong. It's the strongest source of bioelectricity in our body, 40 to 60 times stronger than the second most powerful source, the brain. It's strong enough that it creates an electromagnetic field, surrounds us, all of us, you, me, Karen, 360 degrees, extending beyond the skin out into space about 3 to 4 feet.
So let's stop right there. This, sure. This electromagnetic field, this gets pretty exciting when you start talking about electromagnetism.
Yeah.
Does that match up with the idea of an aura around somebody?
Well, no. An aura is something people believe in that has never really been definitively proven. Mm-hmm. It's a different sort of bandwidth of energy, in my opinion. The field we're looking at, and I don't discount that there are auras or non-local fields, all that. That's all, you know, very real in my world. Mm-hmm. But in terms of what we're measuring here, we're measuring just regular electromagnetic energy, kind of like radio waves. Mm-hmm. What's interesting about it, though, is that that field changes. The frequencies in that field change depending upon what we are experiencing emotionally. Angry, upset, all that produces what's called an incoherent spectrum in that field. Lots of frequencies fighting for power, about like it feels. Uh-huh. Conversely, if we're experiencing emotions long associated with this concept of heart, like care, compassion, love, appreciation, those kind of emotions, it produces a coherent field. So in essence, what we're doing through our emotional responses, we're encoding that electromagnetic field. Now, everything's putting out some sort of a field. All living things are connected energetically, and we are encoding these fields all the time by what we are feeling, what we are choosing to feel, the perceptions that we have, and the emotional responses to those perceptions, and then our choice of emotion encoding that field. And as my friend Greg Braden, who's a close friend of mine, said one time when we were talking, he said, we all live in a field of energy that is reflecting back to us, not what we think in our minds, but what we feel in our hearts. And to me, that statement's more true than ever. We put that out electromagnetically and other fields that we're not measuring in the same defined way, imprinting the field of consciousness. Consciousness is reflecting back to us. So it puts a lot of new meaning around an old term. A change of heart changes everything.
That's very good. So when you say it changes everything, when your field changes around you, mm-hmm. and it obviously affects the things that are at least close by you, what are the results of that? Can the energy or your field that you're creating with your heart affect a larger situation when you walk into a room of people?
Yeah, I believe it can, and there's some research we've done that indicates that. You know, one person who's operating in a level of a term we have for this is called heart coherence. That's when all the heart, brain, body communication is working in synchronicity and harmony. Mm-hmm. It's a high-performance state, highly efficient state, physiologically and emotionally. One coherent person can influence a lot of incoherent people. You know, one coherent person can have an effect on not just a room, but a town. You know, the implications get huge when you go from Newtonian science into quantum physics, where the boundaries of time and space are not as defined the same way they are in Newtonian physics. You know, so now you're looking at infinite possibility of what we're doing as human beings every time we make an emotional shift out of anger and frustration to acceptance and appreciation, you know, out of sadness into joy. I could give many more examples, but we are encoding that field and we are influencing consciousness in a way. And we're all sort of in that same field of consciousness, and it's from that field that we're drawing our reality. So in a sense, how we perceive, especially what we're putting out from our heart, is giving us the ability to understand the co-creative process between us individually and collectively as a human race with the field of consciousness itself. And so that's some of the things we do here at HeartMath, but that's the wide stuff. We're very pragmatic in our approach to it. Bottom line, people, we do lots of training programs, everything from the underserved to the U.S. military, Fortune 100 companies, educational systems, major healthcare institutions, and we don't train in those places because we talk about quantum non-local energetic fields. Uh-huh. We train there because we talk about things like being able to regulate your emotions so that you can think more clearly, so that you can have less stress, so that the healthcare cost in your organization goes down because your employees are operating in another level of internal emotional wellness. This is how we position HeartMath in the world. So one of the things I find fascinating about what's been accomplished here is the breadth of understanding of heart. Yeah. That we've developed, everything from the high-end cosmic understanding right down to the street of, you know, what do you do when your wife's mad at you? You know, uh-huh. It's that kind of an approach that we've taken. And we've always kind of been in the middle. When Doc was helping to direct us in the beginning strategically about things, he said, you know, work from the middle. You know, it's shorter to go either direction from there. You know, you don't have to work down to the where the people are suffering the most, or up here where you have all the brilliant scientists or the highly educated, go in the middle. And then you can go this way or you can go that way. So we've been in this movement, I guess, I would call ourselves the conservative liberals. You know, we've been more pragmatic in some ways than other organizations. And they do their thing as too. It's not a competitive thing or us better than others, but our style is a bit more down the middle.
Yeah, and being down the middle and being in a practical mode like that obviously allows you to communicate with people in corporate situations or in organizational situations. One of the things that we have noticed, however, in talking to some of the people that we've interviewed, Howard, is that some very heavy-duty intellectual types are beginning to make the journey in their own lives from the head to the heart.
Yeah.
And they're beginning to say, wait a minute, my heart is more important than my head. But that's almost like a jumping ship from where these high intellectual achievers go. Are you part of people helping people understand that?
Yeah, I think so. If we provide a foundation or some fundamentals that help people find that out for themselves is what we do. And I think it's part of the times, really. I mean, I've said this in a lot of interviews. It's sort of heart time on the planet. You know, a heart-based world is emerging. It's part of the new intelligence bandwidth that's coming in through what's been generically called, and many of the people watching this today will know about this term, the shift, this shift in consciousness that's happening that most people sense and beginning to see unfold more now. What we're coming into is different. I used this term a minute ago, bandwidths of intelligence, whereas the box is widening around what intelligence can be and what that brings us in terms of what we can understand and how we perceive. Heart's got a lot to do with that. Heart, brain, at a physiological level, nothing's in competition here. It's an integrated system. You know, they both play a role. But we can't just look at intelligence anymore as just that logical, linear process. There's another more intuitive understanding of intelligence that's coming in now. It gives us the ability to perceive differently. So people are naturally beginning to come into that because they're feeding off the field of consciousness, which itself is changing, right? So they're drawing from it, and it's morphing, so they're starting to think that way. Another thing is that, you know, a lot of times people just are getting worn out, with the logical linear approach, and they start to develop an appetite to manifest more of the values and things that they have in their life. They don't want to just be on the same ambition-driven grind anymore, and it doesn't feel good to them. It doesn't feel fulfilling. So what happens when people get to that place in their life is they begin to dig a little deeper. You know, that's when they may meditate or pray or take that walk off into the woods or get in the car and drive off into the night. And they're looking for, what's the meaning of this? Why am I living my life this way? You know, how can I make changes that I need to make? Why am I not happy? These are questions that many people are asking. As they dig a little deeper, what they find is not just some digital, logical, linear play out of that. What they find is their heart, and the heart's going, here I am, I've been waiting for you, glad you finally showed up, I've been waiting here all along. And even then the inner dialogue starts to change for people as they begin to make that fundamental contact with something that's been there all along. So people are experiencing that, and once they get a taste of it, they want more of it.
Yes, they do.
So it's a process for people that's starting to blend these things together so that certain qualities of the heart have more applicability in the context of their life in general. And I see that a lot too, and I'm glad you do in your travels. Just people going through a natural evolutionary change within themselves, some born from the school of hard knocks, some born from the fact that consciousness itself is changing.
Yeah, Karen and I both spent an adequate amount of time in corporate America.
Mm-hmm.
Back before all this stuff started.
Mm-hmm.
And it always felt cold and unfriendly and kind of lonesome.
Yeah.
And if when I had experiences where my heart was involved in something and I dared to let it show, yeah. I wound up feeling like, well, I'm the odd man out of this game. And yet by the same token, there's some automatic identification ability that we have that we know who's the guy with the open heart, don't we?
Yeah, you sense it, don't you? And they're the ones people want to resonate more with.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a lot of power games going on, and I'm not down on companies and corporations or any of that. I mean, it's just they're people, they're systems. The systems have to go through change, so I'm not demonizing any of that. it is a bit cold, it is a bit sterile. I've been in those places, I've done training in those places, I've done keynotes in those organizations and all of that, and it is a different environment. Yeah. And at the same time, when you are able to sit down one-on-one with most any of these folks and really connect with them as human beings, you find out, boy, they got a heart in there and then some, you know. Yeah. But the culture in which they work doesn't seem to allow for the expression of it.
Yeah.
That's changing, though, you know, over time. Not overnight, but, you know, and business still has to be business. In my role here at HeartMath, I have to do business, and I have to make business decisions, and it's about, where do I find this balance and this blend? You know, I would prefer I never had to do business again, that, you know, we could just give everything away here at HeartMath, but, you know, but we have a big organization here, and we have a very, I think, important mission, and without some structure around that mission, without some business behind that mission, the mission doesn't get done. Uh-huh. So it's this constant balance for me between me just wanting to be the altruistic, open-hearted to world guy, and the guy who has to say no, or the guy who has to say, this is not going to happen this way, or we need to redirect this to there, and, you know, I have to enforce things as in my job about the use of our intellectual property and all these other things that come up in business. I think I blend it pretty well, but I do see the challenge that people have in a company, for example, where they have the values and the heart, but the system they're in is not going to allow for that. A lot of people, as a result, yourselves probably, that had some influence over why you didn't finish your career there, right?
Might have had some influence. Yeah.
Yeah, why you're not there now, or you decided that's not what you're going to do.
Our hearts are so big, it's just like, woo!
Yeah, so you can't... But the containers are changing as well. I don't think business will be... 50 years from now, I think we'll look back at what business is and how it functions. It'll be almost impossible to believe we did it this way.
Yeah.
And it won't be long. 50 years is a long time in one regard and a short amount of time in others. And I think it's changing that quickly.
Yeah, it's really hard right now to look back on pictures of work scenes from 100 years ago.
I know, the industrial thing, yeah.
Yeah, and it just all looks like, what was that? How'd they do that?
I don't know. I worked one summer in a factory when I was about 18 years old. My dad put me in one. It was a factory in Richmond, Virginia, and it was exactly that. It was a factory, you know, where people, you came to work, you stood in front of a big gate in front of this building, and a whistle blew, and you went in, and you worked, and at a certain time, a whistle blew, and you walked off, and you had 15 minutes break, and the whistle blew, and you went back, and lunch was that way. And I remember, you know, I got there, and one day, working out on the floor of the factory, the boss of that floor came out and blew a whistle and stopped everybody and said, stop for a second, you know, Mary, come here. And he brought this woman out, and, you know, it was her last day of work, and they gave her a watch, and off she went. She'd been doing it for 50 years. She came into that factory at age 16 years old, and she was 66. That's why my father sent me to that factory, to show me this is not what...
This is an option you could
this
have.
This is an option for you, son, but this is not where you need to end up, because this is what happens in these places. And all it took was, and I remember that I'm telling you on camera right now, first time I've ever told that story on camera, but I'm telling you that it stuck in my memory of, like, how does anybody go through that regimented pattern like that and get to the end of their entire life's work and they blow a whistle and hand you a watch and tell you thank you very much and you've been there 50 years ever since you were 16 years old. Something's not right with the way this is working. So I think business will change in these times. And, you know, I get asked in interviews a lot, and I'll ask the question for you, you know, what do you think the shift's going to be? You know, and I've developed a really fantastic answer for that.
Great. Go.
I don't know. The reason I don't know is that none of us know. It's like we can't quite see around that corner yet, because here's why we don't know. We're going through a major shift in consciousness, you know, using a term, a dimensional shift. We're shifting like a dimension and a half over approximately 100-year period of time, which is a really tight window. We're right in the middle of it now. Nothing like this has ever happened in our world before. And so what the result of this is going to be is not just what we see today with new clothes on it, something completely different that we've never seen before, and we can't quite see it yet. It'd be like walking up to a guy sitting on a horse and buggy in the late 1800s and saying, I've heard some rumors about some really interesting new transportation that will be coming. What do you think about that? And the guy's probably figuring out a different buggy or a different horse, but he can't see an airline industry. You know, and that's where we are today. We can't quite see that what's next, but it's coming. We feel it. That's what's most important. We feel it. We believe it. We're putting our hearts into it. You are through your TV show. I am, and my colleagues here at HeartMath through what we do. Millions of people around the world are doing all these wonderful things. So people are sensing it and feeling it and smelling it. I have an advantage in one way that I get to travel some, and I get to travel internationally. And I just like talking to people and finding out what they may be feeling. So I'll ask a cab driver in London or something, you know, tell me about, you know, how your life's been feeling these days, you know. And the general answer will get, oh, I'll tell you, it's getting so crazy and getting so fast. I mean, I just can't keep up with it anymore. And, you know, to be honest with you, and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, it's like, just speed up. And I get that everywhere I go.
Yeah.
And so it is getting faster.
Yeah, and we've asked scientists, is time actually speeding up, or is it something else? What have you heard an answer to that question?
I've heard it's speeding up. There is actually speed up in time itself. Now, time is one of those things that I never understood, and every time I've tried to understand it and watch a movie on or a TV show or something like that about time, I end up more confused by the end of the show than I was before it started. So I'm not an expert on time by any means, but I think that the time and the fabric of time, so to speak, is actually changing as part of the shift. It's speeding up. The way I see time in one regard, very simplistically, is that it's about events that happen over a certain span. There are more events happening within a certain span of time than ever before, so you could look at it abstractly and say time is speeding up from that perspective. More's happening in less time. So more happens in a minute than it used to, so that minute is faster. Sense.
And we're more aware of it all over the world.
We're feeling it, yeah. People feel it. And there's a lot of people that don't know anything about the shift. They don't even know the term. They look at you like, you know, you're crazy if you talk about a shift that's going on. But if you ask them in a different way, they'll describe it to you.
Yeah.
You know, they describe it in the context of the way their life is feeling. Not so much in, there's this big shift happening, and this 2012 year is important because of this alignment. They don't know about that. You know, it's just like, the LA knows that, wow, you know, it seems like change is happening faster than I can keep up with it.
Yeah. One of the images that we heard even yesterday, Karen, was, and I don't know whether it's apocryphal or not, but the story of about a shaman in one of the tribes along the Gulf of Mexico when the Spaniards came in. And they'd never seen a ship like the Spaniards were sailing.
Mm-hmm.
And they couldn't even see it. And the shaman was the only person that could see it, although it was right in front of his eyes.
I've heard that story. I think I've heard it. Yeah, it's amazing. You know, we can't see certain things because it's too unreal for us.
Yeah.
And I think that's the way it is now. Another thing I had a thought about a number of years ago is kind of like, what was one of the most important discoveries of these modern times? And it ended up being, my thoughts were about it, was electricity. Electricity changed everything. This, you know, we're sitting here today because of electricity. You know, electricity just changed the world completely. If you think about it, and what did electricity do? It brought us out of the darkness into the light. It created everything from cars to cameras to communications to all the things we have today. Were really an outgrowth of that one discovery of electricity. How many thousands of years had civilized human beings been living on this planet with electricity sitting right there in front of them, and yet we didn't see it?
Yeah.
So not just from an energy perspective, but what's sitting in front of our face today that we aren't seeing? Which brings me back around to heart. It's through the eyes of the heart we'll begin to see those things, not through the linearity of our minds.
Do you remember what the little prince said?
No.
One cannot see rightly with the eyes. It is only through the heart that you can see what is essential.
There you go. I think that's true. There's been a lot of statements like that over the years where people were kind of on to it. But now what's happening is it's coming into fruition, where it's becoming real. What we've done here at HeartMath is done some science and put some context around it, give it an empirical understanding so that it takes a phrase like that and makes it real. Mm-hmm. It's a translation that we've done here. So we've done pretty good at putting some words around it and some language and doing enough science to give it credibility. You know, our science was never designed to take the heart out of heart, you know, to make it something cold. It was to give it that groundedness that we felt it needed, that Doc Childry felt it needed. That's why he calls it heart math. Math doesn't mean mathematics, it just means empirical, you know, just like psychological equations, you know, of things. But we wanted to give heart a better solid baseline so that it could be more easily accepted. I've sometimes said that the science that our researchers have done have given the head to go ahead and believe in the heart, the permission. Because, you know, I can describe this chair to you, but if I can show you this chair, it's a lot more real. So if I can take heart out of philosophy and spirituality, give it some scientific context, show that, in fact, it's sending signals to the brain that influence the brain and the body and all that, it gives it that empirical understanding, and then all of a sudden the heart becomes more real. It's solid in people.
Yeah.
And then it allows them to go ahead and believe in something they feel anyhow. And once they do, then the power of belief increases and their lives begin to change.
Yeah. Up until a certain point, most of the adults that are walking around had that experience when they went to a good Walt Disney movie.
Yeah.
But when they walked out, it was back in the real world.
That's right. So that's where our tools and techniques, the training things we do. We have a course called Heart Mastery, which I'd like all the listeners to know about. It's where you take courses from your computer. We've already pre-recorded them. Myself, Deborah Rosman, a woman named Sheva Carr. You listen to your class and you have a workbook you download. Then for every course that we give, there's a live discussion group every week. So it's a combination of talking about it. I got to leave this interview in a little while and go do the live discussion call for the intermediate course that's happening, you know, now at the Heart Mastery. But so it's got the human component in it, but you learn that way. The reason we have things like that is that people do need tools and techniques. They need some structure around that, because you can, without that, you do walk out of the Disney movie. And you can have a heartful experience, and then you go and you find out you left your lights on in your car and the battery's dead, and you know, and then you got to go through that whole thing, but and all the grumbling and griping about that, you know what I mean? But trying not to, but doing it anyhow. Well, it's okay, it's no big deal, but you know, inside, you know, and, you know. So we need tools for that, right? We need the ways we use the heart in these practical ways, and that's why we have Heart Mastery courses. That's why we teach in corporations and you know all that, but. It's designed that way. The science gives it empirical understanding. The tools, techniques, the methods, the training give us a way that which we can manifest more heart in our life. The end result is just us doing our part to create a heart-based world, and to do our part in sort of following the flow of what's naturally happening anyway. So I think we're an outgrowth of something larger, where we just were able to see that and see that as our mission. And then go for it.
But you also developed tools to help people. You've developed the EM wave.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about how that operates.
I've heard about it. Sounds pretty cool.
God love you.
It's a little handheld device. I should have brought one with me to the interview. It's about the size of a cell phone. It measures changes in what's called our heart rhythms. The scientific name for that type of measurement is called heart rate variability. If we go to our doctor, the doctor says, hey, you know, Chuck, your heart rate 75 beats a minute. Well, you probably walk out of there going, my heart was beating at 75 beats a minute. That was an average, because what really happens every moment of every day with any of us is our heartbeats are changing subtly. Timing between heartbeats is changing very subtly all the time. And as you look at this, these really interesting patterns begin to emerge with the heart speeding up and slowing down and speeding up and slowing down. When heart-brain-body communication is working optimally, the heart rhythms have this smooth sine wave-like order, and that's called heart coherence. I know for all you listening, I'm throwing out a lot of concepts now, so bear with me. Heart coherence is this highly ordered state. It's the state that someone gets into, like an athlete when they're in the zone, for example, or it's a state somebody gets into like when they're meditating and they really hit that solid place inside where they do feel a connection to their larger self. You know, that would be heart coherence. The M wave, EMWAVE, you know, reason I spell that out is because with my southern accent, sometimes I do interviews and then we start getting calls at the offices wanting to know about Amway. The M wave. EMWAVE, it measures heart rhythms, and then it's got a patented process and algorithm built into it that looks at that heart rhythm and scores it for the degree of heart coherence, low, medium, or high.
How does it read that? Is it just your pulse or your
finger? So the handheld device has a little sensor you plug into it, clips to your ear, and then it picks up your pulse, converts it into heart rhythm data, and then the patented process analyzes the heart rhythms and determines how coherent they are. So you use it as a training device to train yourself to get into heart coherence so you can carry it into your day. So it has a little light at the top that goes from red to blue to green, low, medium, high. It has tones in there for medium and high, so you can tell when you're there and you do it with your eyes closed. And this has become hugely popular. It's really, people are already thinking to themselves, it sounds like biofeedback. Yeah. Well, generically it is. Biofeedback, in its true sense, is all about brain waves. This is heart. This is looking at heart rhythms. Mm-hmm. So we came out with this technology, and it's in a computer-based form, which we still have a computer-based version in the handheld device that also plugs into the computer, about the year 2000. And we've sold these things in over 85 countries around the world. Hundreds of thousands of people use M-Waves. Everything from mental health professionals to Olympic athletes to school teachers to tens and tens of thousands of people that are involved in spiritual growth practices. It just goes on and on and on of where M-Waves are today. And so that's exciting for us. One of the things I will tell the listeners, August 23rd, there'll be a new app coming out. It's actually an app that's being done by Huffington Post and AOL called GPS for the Soul.
Oh, wow. I love it.
We play a major role in it. We're part of it. HeartMath's coherence technology is built into the app. Wow. What you'll be able to do is to get a coherence reading from putting your finger on the camera of your iPhone.
Yeah.
It picks up the pulse from the camera. Now, it doesn't give as accurate a reading as you get from like an M-Wave when you have ear clip and higher sampling rate, etc. But it will give you some sense of coherence, and then from that coherent state you'll be able to choose different things you want to do within the app, like experiences and different ones. Like we have our own experience. Wow. Deepak Chopra will have one, Marianne, you know, different ones, and they'll have their own experiences. But GPS for the Soul will be out soon. So that's a way in which we now license the same technology into other things. There's games developed in China that have our algorithm in them. You know, there's coherence is becoming quite popular, and we've been known because of our science to be the leader in that field of understanding heart coherence and then how to translate it into devices and things like that.
Wow,
isn't that cool?
That's
wonderful.
The technology side I mentioned. Remember back to the beginning interview, I said it's techniques, methods, and technology. So I'm glad Karen, you know, asked me that question. That's all part of HeartMath, and it's just tools we've created to do what? To put people in touch with this. And again, bringing technology into it added a whole another layer of applicability in our society today when we developed those devices.
Yeah, and I can see where the minute that app comes out with all those logos on it from Huffington Post and AOL and everybody else, mm-hmm. This is going to open up a huge, big discussion.
I think it will. That's why we did it. It was a good alliance for us, and a good, you know, joint venture with Huffington Post and AOL. Arianna Huffington is a big project for her. But we knew it was going to reach a lot of people, and we wanted Heart to be play a prominent role in it, and so did they. They understand the importance of Heart big time and what they're trying to accomplish there, and they wanted to have that as a part of it, so we ended up being the partner that they chose. And I think it's just, again, endemic of the times. You know, here comes a major organization coming out with an app that's got everything to do with a person's personal and spiritual growth. It's got a heart-centric component in the middle of it, and HeartMath plays a role in it, but it's all part of that bigger shift of that heart-based world emerging right in front of our eyes.
Now, I'm going to ask you a question that I think could go both ways, and if it does, I want to hear both sides of it. But how are religious organizations responding to all of this?
You know, I think because of our neutrality, we've been so down the middle that we've gotten great response. Sure, the New Thought churches and things like that, they've been into HeartMath for years, you know, and all this, that sort of thing. As far as, you know, other religions, I mean, I can say this, it's isolated things, but I spoke last year, I spoke in Kuwait. And I was brought in by an organization there that my talk attracted people from all over the Arab world, countries that we never have any contact with, you know, where people were there, and the response was phenomenal. And they were, you know, it was men on one side, women on the other, women with veils, the whole thing, and just the response that, you know, that I got to that was amazing. They asked me to come back out on. And after I got through for some pictures, I thought, and I stood there and had pictures taken for at least 30 straight minutes, you know, where just one after the other, one after the other, one after the other, flashbulbs going off, two or three cameras at the same time, of response to that message of Heart. You know, so that was a Muslim response, right? far as the United States, I mean, I know we've had lots of ecumenical organizations that like what we do and Christian organizations because, you know, they at the core of a lot of the Christian teachings, you know, Jesus' message was about heart, and he was a man of the extraordinary heart. He was, you know, who knows, maybe the most heartful person that's ever been on this planet. So we're neutral about all that. You know, we've never been about one religion or the other religion, those kind of things. We keep it down the middle, and we're about facilitating things. We're not about competing with things. And my feeling is you can take whatever's out there in the world, not just religions, but whatever's out there, and add heart to it, you don't lose anything. Yeah. You know, you add another level of quality to things when you put heart into things. And so I think if people can see us through that lens, then it's fine. If they have really sort of their own values around it that are stricter than that, then that's respected and honored, and maybe they don't like heart math. But I would understand that. It's just about belief systems, and I'm not in judgment of everybody's belief system. But our neutrality, again, allows us to be accessible because we aren't caught up in one side or the other, and because we approach things with science and empirical understandings and things like that, it's easier for people to access it and to turn it into what they need it to be.
Has the politician ever come to you and says, teach me how to reach people in their heart?
Yeah.
Yeah, and what happened?
Well, politicians it's like corporation people, like I mentioned earlier, you know, at the deeper level, that they're often extraordinarily deep people with big hearts, but they're working in a political system. Right, and that system itself is a big system. I mean, getting something like we were talking earlier about corporations, but getting the system of business or the system of politics to turn around, it's like getting the Queen Mary to take a U-turn. I mean, it takes time, you know, for that thing to, you know, to do its loop, and that's what's going on now. It's trying. That's some of the tension you feel today. Because the systems are going through such rapid change, they can't keep up with the needs, and so they're sort of crumbling in front of our faces. Because what you have happening is this new world that's sort of birthing in the midst of the old one. And as it pushes out, and the old one's going, wait a minute, hold on, I call the shots here. It's pushing back, you know what I mean? And then you got this pushing that, this pushing back, and you got this tension, and finally something breaks. And a lot of times it's the system that's breaking, whether it's, you know, education system, religious systems, whatever system.
Yeah, and everybody feels that. And it's creating a tremendous amount of discord and fear,
yeah,
and uncertainty and suspicion. It's breaking trust down, because who can you trust?
That's right. So what it's forcing us to do is to trust the only thing we can trust, which is us.
Our heart.
Our heart.
That's right. We're our own best friend and our own most reliable guide to making decisions, yeah, big and small, as we go through the game of life, is here in the heart. It's the endemic of the times. It's pushing us towards that one place where we can find our self-security, because you're right, we can't trust much anything out here anymore. We have to find it inside. That's part of the shift. That's the good news part of it. I mean, you know, I was talking to Doc a week or so ago, and he was saying, you know, yeah, the speed up you experience and all the stuff getting busier, you know, in your job and your work and all that stuff you go through there. He said, that's part of it. He said, but you got to look at it this way. The reason all that's getting faster is because your consciousness and awareness is speeding up. That's the good news side of this.
Yeah.
You know, there's an upside to this whole thing. Keep spinning it to the up.
And people do sense that there is something that we're in the middle of becoming. And do people want it to be faster? Do they want to get there? Let's figure out what it is. Yeah. Or is there some shoe dragging along the way?
Well, both. There's shoe dragging along the way in one regard, because people just don't quite want to, you know, have to make the changes they need to make. So there's a resistance, you know, to change. That's just human nature. And so that resistance is there, and people still putting off doing some things that they know they need to do, things they've been working on their whole life, or things that they know they needed to work on their whole life but don't do. You know, that drag is there, and that's running out of real estate. The highway, the pavement's running out on that road, you know, as people, you know, continue down that one. At the same time, people want things to happen fast too, but a lot of times they want something phenomenalistic to happen. They want some external to cause a change. They want some,
yeah,
big bang to happen, and
yeah,
we all wake up and everything's wonderful. And, you know, it's like, it's a progression, it's a process, and there's magic, so to speak, if people want that, happening around us all the time. But if we can't just sit around waiting for a specific calendrical date or something else external to ourselves to come along and bail this thing out, we're earning our way into it. My feeling, though, is that we've already crossed some important lines in a good way. that we've already avoided some of the things that would have been a lot worse. We've got some tough road to walk as a global society. There are some problems that look bigger than we can solve, but yet that new intelligence is waiting for us to discover the solutions. It's there. And I think that we've got a tremendous opportunity in front of us. So I think we've crossed some lines where we don't have to worry about apocalyptic scenarios. We don't have to worry about all that. I think we're beyond that now. I think there's enough people that have done enough work that have moved past that resistance, that drag, and taken some steps that were important, that we've pushed it across the line. We still have work to do, plenty of it, but I think we've really won the game, so to speak, you know, in a way. But more to come. And I know for me, there's always an inner feeling, inner push that there's things I need to do more of or less of. And, you know, there's that inner refinement that's always going on. And that's part of what's needed right now, I think. I think the missing step in this whole process has been looking outside ourselves to do it, that what's being asked of us now is take some steps, human beings, you know, be that person you really can be. Do it from the strongest source of security you have in yourself, which is your heart. Put your heart into every single thing you do. You just operate simplistically from a more position of love, care, appreciation, compassion, and kindness. Don't worry about the small stuff. Just quit judging and complaining about things, and everything will be all right.
Amen. And it's a so tell me, you have this incredible.
It's not even Sunday.
Well, I wasn't sure there.
That was wonderful.
You have this incredible campus here, and you bring people in to do training. What type of training do the people who come here receive?
Well, we don't do that much training here anymore, actually, Karen. The type of training we do here are certification-type courses, for mostly for people that are trainers within companies or organizations that are being trained. They're nonprofit. We do have some training for educators. We have training for people that want to deliver programs into other nonprofit organizations, underserved markets, things like that. There's a training we're doing for people that want to train in police departments. Some of that still gets done here. A lot of it we've moved off-site, or we moved it online, actually, you know, to the, like Heart Mastery, like I mentioned earlier. Rather than trying to do personal development seminars here, we can do it.
Oh, you can get a lot more people.
Mm-hmm. And in many ways, more convenient for them,
right,
and less expensive for them. And then there'll be times when we get together. We are going to do an event this December, first week in December, in Mexico. It'll be done down in the Maya area. It's not like a totally overt 2012 event. We're just going to offer this. We can only take 100 people, being a luxury resort outside of Cancun that's specially set up for this, with a, it's called the Tao Wellness Center down there, and we're going to do that. So that's a chance like for us to get together face to face. But a lot of the training we're doing now is being done other ways, either off-site or whatever, because we just can't take this facility. It's only but so big, and we find ourselves sort of running a little hotel over the years here, you know, and it's a little bit labor intensive for us. So we find ways to modernize it, to get it to more people, so more people can benefit from whatever we've done here.
Well, thank God for these programs that are available to us to tap in online, because I think a lot of people don't have the opportunity to get out of their, you know, they can be working, they can be taking the class at night, they can be doing their reading whenever they have time. It's really an amazing thing what opportunities that we have now with the internet.
That's right. We just have had a course for years called the HeartMath One-on-One Provider Program. That's where we train people to be a coach that can coach using HeartMath methods. And we've done it forever here at this facility. Last weekend was the last one we will do here. And there's 25 people here. Well, now we're moving it to a phone-based. It isn't all just passive online. It's all done via telephone and interacting that way. But, you know, if you think about people who have to come out here, there's fees to come to the program, then the fees of travel. Then it's a three-day program here, which means it's at the very least it's a day of travel in the front, a day of travel in the back. You're talking 5 or 6 days out and all of that. Now, a lot of people love it because they get to come here, but for a lot of people, they've wanted to be in this program for a long time, but they just couldn't afford to be away that long, or the travel cost was, you know, it was too much extra for them. So we've changed the program. And it's not trying to disassociate from people in any way. It's just, how do we get this bigger? How do we reach more people at an important time. We have to change what we do, the way we go about it. So it's just us trying to meet the needs of our mission and of the people to make those kind of changes.
Well, with all the, there are more and more people waking up and becoming more aware of what's really going on and what their individual role is in the global consciousness. So I think that the more they have access to the program that you do, then it helps them to be able to stay grounded and to stay in that place where they're resonating at the, you know, at the most perfect frequency.
That's right. And that people are doing it out there in the world. We're just doing our part in, you know, in contributing to that. But people are, like you said, and they are coming into a new awareness about themselves. The term sometimes people use is waking up, and they are waking up and they're making contributions. Heart Mastery's tagline is find your heart purpose, help create a better world. You know, that's, you know, that's what we're trying to do here, is find, help people align with what they're really, really supposed to be doing. Then how do we contribute collectively?
We heard something yesterday that is kind of a mystery inside of a mystery, but we've been places where you can walk into a restaurant and here's a family of four sitting down at a really nice table in a restaurant, and the kids and the parents are all four working on their individual texting machines and paying attention to these little tiny screens as if there is nothing else in the world going on around them. And yesterday somebody said to us, what that's about is we have almost an obsessive desire to be in connection. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, these technological tools are helping us understand that we can do that.
Yeah.
Does that make any sense?
Yeah, I think people want connection with one another, and certainly the technology is giving people to connect in a different kind of way, a unique way. And so there's assets and deficits. You know, I call it living life through the small screen. You know, and so you're myopically focused here, so you're missing whatever's going on here. Yeah. But at the same time, as you're myopically focused here, you could be focused here, accessing a bigger world than the one you're sitting in. So it goes both ways. So it's about balance. It's about how you use that technology in a proactive way without shutting yourself off. Because what it does in another way is it actually begins to desensitize us. It dehumanizes the personal experience, where then the conversation they should, not should, but may be enjoyable with their family is not happening. Right. So it can be stuff going on right in front of their face that didn't get talked about because they're off on, you know, Game Boy Land or something, you know, playing with a device. So it goes both ways. So there's an asset and a deficit to it. I do think, for the most part, it's probably too much of it. I know that a lot of people, myself included, have gone through phases where we woke up and recognized, man, these things are starting to eat me up. You know what I mean? It's eating up too much of my own consciousness. I need to back off. I need to just create a different set of habits around the use of my cell phone and the use of this and that and the other. So we do. Finally, we get there. But I don't know. I think, you know, it opens up the world. It connects us. People want connection. At the same time, it's a lot of mind stimulation. It pulls us out of a deeper connection with ourselves and others. So it's about finding a balance with those things.
There's another question in this area that's a little bit more, I think the word is delicate. I don't know anybody personally who wants war. But we've got a lot of war going on around us that this country is producing. And what kind of things can you do with people who are coming back from war? Are you doing anything like that?
Absolutely. One of the areas of growth that we've seen in the last few years where we've been able to make a really nice contribution, one I'm extremely proud of, is with the military. Institute of HeartMath is doing training. There's training going on right now today, you know, in the U.S. military somewhere, where we're training soldiers who are deploying. We've got contracts with the Navy, Air Force, Army, all those things. And that's something important because we're giving them skills that they take with them, you know, for, you know, it's just language a bit differently, like operational readiness, you know, and things like that for them. On the back end, using the M-Way primarily, there are lots and lots of mental health professionals who are using the M-Wave with returning soldiers. And we work directly with those mental health professionals. We're in, I think, 50 or more VA centers, for example. And so we are training the health professionals on heart coherence and understanding that, emotional self-regulation techniques, using the M-Wave in a treatment protocol with the soldiers, and we've gotten phenomenal results. And anecdotal stories from the soldiers themselves is amazing. You know, the testimonials, so to speak, that, you know, that they've given us have been phenomenal. And it's one of the things that the a number of the health professionals that work with these people have told us is the thing that works the most. You know, that you guys connect people back to their core, to their heart, and that helps to move them through the PTSD and a lot of the other things. So we have some full-time staff on it. That's what they do here. They work with the military. And so, again, taking that practical application to heart. You know, we don't go in the military talking about, you know, the shift and all that. Now, we're not trying to hide it, just not the right venue for that, right?
Right.
But we go.
You have to go where people are.
You talk about operational readiness. You talk about the importance of emotional self-regulation in terms of efficiency, in terms of well-being and things like that. They understand that easily, you know, and it translates very well. But without the science as a translator, then it's just another philosophy, some heart-based thing out of California, and it's more difficult, you know. Hey, what are you laughing at? You better smile when you say it. But it's another one of those kind of things. But that's why we built it like we built it. And I'm going to give Doc Childry today, right now on camera, like I've done many times, the credit for that. You know, he's an amazing man. It's his vision. He's the one that's given us the overall guidance on this for all these years. We implement it. We do what we do. But without Doc and him stepping back many years ago out of his care and saying, wow, this place is going to start rocking and rolling before too long, and let's try to do something to help it out, and coming up with some brilliant ways of doing that really is what Doc did. And so we've, I think, got a pretty good combination of ingredients here to do our part in acknowledging and respecting the many, many millions of people, including the folks like you that are listening and watching right now, for all that you're doing. And I'd like to thank you personally, but obviously I don't know you. I'm talking to a camera at the moment, Chuck and Karen, but if you're watching this kind of a show and you've watched this long putting up with a hillbilly with an expanded vocabulary, you're probably a person that cares about the world, and you probably already made great contributions to the world, and I want to thank you for that. And I also want to thank you for the contributions that I believe you'll make in the future, because there's people like you that do represent the hope for the world, and I want to honor you for that and appreciate you for that.
Wow, that's wonderful.
Thank you, Howard. It's been such a blessing being here with you today. We've enjoyed it so
yeah,
much.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, it's very rare that we get such a beautiful setting and such a bright person.
Oh, thank you.
to be so open and so real about this. And we know what you're doing is important. Mm. And I think back to that quote. I believe Woody Allen made it at one point in his life. And he said, the heart wants what the heart wants.
I like that. Yeah, that's good.
You know, the heart wants it. And what our hearts want, now I know this from my own experience. We want these moments when you can simply be open and free and giving and off guard, and to be that kind of freedom. We all want that.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow or another, there's some roadblocks to being there. But you're one of the people, and your organization is one of the organizations that are making it possible to find our way back to our hearts.
That's right. That's all. That's it. You know, it's been said a long time ago in somebody's teaching that the longest journey a person would ever take was a journey from here to here. You know, it's only 18 inches, so let's get on with it.
Wow. Yeah, it's a big, big journey, and we're seeing more and more people make that journey all the time.
Well, you know, the road is clearly marked now, and there's a bridge of created by care, the bridge of care, I call it, that leads us to the heart. And it's through our care for ourselves and for others that we find that heart. And that bridge is clearly marked right now. So just care and go for it. And know that the heart-based world is emerging and that we're all part of it. And that it'll get easier as we go. We got challenges, as I mentioned earlier, to face. But we have everything we need to meet those challenges. And it starts right in the middle of our chest.
Yeah, exactly. And a big wind just blew here to underline exactly what he said. There is a big wind blowing in the world right now.
It is.
And you're part of it, and the people that are watching this are part of it. And we all know that it is not an ill wind. It's a great wind.
That's right.
That's pushing our sails way into waters we never dreamed we'd be in.
True. And Karen and Chuck, I want to thank you for hosting a show like this, for taking your time to do it. I know it's a labor of love for you. And, you know, I appreciate it, and thank you for having me and letting me represent HeartMath for you today here on your show.
The pleasure is all ours. Karen?
God bless you, Howard. All the work you've done in this world.
Thank you very much.
We're very grateful for your time.
Okay.
Thank you so much, Howard. This has really been a blessing for us and our viewers. And obviously, you're a blessing for the people you come in contact with all the time.
Well, thank you so much.
Bless you.
Take care, everybody. Bye now.
That's wonderful. Great. Perfect.
Okay. It's okay.
That's terrific.